Okay. Oye, mi gente. ¿Cómo están todos? That's a common thing you might hear, loosely translated. Hey, my people. How is everybody? And of course, as Jeff mentioned, my name is Ish Martinez. This is my very first Zoom presentation. I've done about 25 of these talks, so I've talked on this subject quite a bit. But I'd like to thank the Walkway Board and the staff, especially Teresa Sanchez, Jeff, and Chris, Kathy, other staff members that have helped to put this together. I really do appreciate it. And I appreciate the opportunity of doing this talk because I like to spread the word about Las Villas as much as I possibly can. I think it's an interesting story. It's a part of Plattekill and Ulster County history, New York State history. So I think it's important for people to know about it. So let's get started. But first, to give you a little bit of a taste, a little bit of a feel for being at Las Villas and what you might hear as you approach Las Villas, I'm going to play a little bit of music, something that would be typical of what you might hear if you had gone to one of the villas that had music. So with that, Teresa, could you play that music? Thank you, Teresa. All right, so that was the El Gran Combo. And they were a very big band out of Puerto Rico. Very popular. They play even today. They're still playing. And that number was called Un Verano en Nueva York, or A Summer in New York. So that is the kind of music. That particular song was a mambo, very popular back in the day. So let me tell you a little bit about me. My wife, Marianne, and I have been married for 48 years. That's right, 48 years, I said. So that makes me pretty old. In fact, I'm 70 years old. I don't know why I'm sharing this, but that's a fact. I have two sons, Adam and Ryan, and two lovely daughter-in-laws, Brittany and Dina. And I also have two grandchildren who have turned 1 year old this year, actually in March, right during the pandemic. So that's unfortunate for them. But like every proud grandparent, I want you to see them. So shamelessly, I'm going to put them up here. Hopefully you can see.
Oh.
Hopefully you can make that out.
Yes. Like,
this is my granddaughter, Mila, and I'm having trouble here. This is my grandson, Liam. Anyway, that didn't work too good for me. But believe me, they are the joy of my life. And they're my first two grandchildren, so even better. Okay. Okay, could you flip the slide, please? All right. So this book is my book, Las Villas of Plattekill in Ulster County. Came out July 25th of 2016. It's part of the Arcadia Local History Series, Images of America. And I'm sure you've seen these if you're interested in history at all. There's one for practically every town in the country. And this is the one that I did. So Teresa, next slide. Okay, a little bit more about me. As I mentioned, this is my first book. I have a computer science degree from Quinnipiac University. I'm a retired systems engineer. I work for both IBM and Verizon. I was born in the Bronx, Puerto Rican descent, and my parents moved to Plattekill when I was just 6 years old. It was a brave move. You know, there was six of us in the family, and it's kind of a new start for my parents, and they decided to buy a farm. Teresa, next slide. Okay, so these are my parents, Lucy and Shorty. My parents themselves grew up in Spanish Harlem, El Barrio, which is in around 110th Street in Manhattan. Very big Hispanic Latino community. There were Spaniards, there were Puerto Ricans, there were Cubans and Dominicans. So it's quite a mix. In 1948, they did buy a farm owned by the Felt family of Plattekill. But eventually they discovered that with all the villas around them, and there were quite a few even when they moved in, why weren't they running a villa, which is what they really loved to do. And so that's when they decided to convert it into a villa. The farm was converted into a villa. Next slide, Teresa. Okay, so this is the villa that they own, Sunny Acres Hotel, or Villa Sunny Acres. This photo here is from 1964. My father was a carpenter by trade, so all the buildings that were built on the property were built by my dad, well, except for the farmhouse, which is the original building. This here shows the dining room to the left, dance hall in the middle, and the bar to the far right. Next slide, Teresa. Okay, so a little bit different than what I've done in past presentations. I've just started out with the villas, but I decided to give a little bit of a history, more or less, of the Catskills and how the villas came to be in that area. The Hudson Valley, of course, for years, and the Catskills have been a vacation mecca since the 1800s, actually. So it goes back quite a ways. Next slide, Teresa. So people were naturally drawn to the Catskills and the Hudson Valley because of its natural beauty and its breathtaking scenery. Also the fact that people loved the outdoors, the fresh air. Was very much in vogue in those days to go into the country. And of course you can see people coming out of the city would just be amazed and at the breathtaking views that you would find in the Catskills. So whether we're talking about, you can go to the next slide, Teresa. So whether we're talking about the romanticized paintings, as in this portrait captured by the Hudson River School of Artists, next slide. Or the scenes captured by photographers. Next slide. Here we have the beautiful Hudson River. Next slide. The region has captured the imagination of millions of people all over the world for years and years and years. This particular shot right here is Catskill Falls, up near Haines Falls and North Lake, just a beautiful area. Next slide. Okay, so looking at the Catskills and the Hudson River area, there were just literally hundreds of accommodations that you would find in the Catskill area. The Catskill Mountain House shown here was one of the more famous and one of the larger hotels that were established in the Catskill region. In fact, this one was started as early as 1824. So you can see the history of going to the Catskills and it being a resort community goes back a long, long way. Next slide, Teresa. This is another great hotel that was in the Catskills, not very far from the Catskill Mountain House, in fact. This was Catterskill Hotel. At the time it was built, it was the largest hotel in the entire country. It had probably close to 400 rooms. And you can, it's just amazing that something so far into, you know, what some people might consider to be the wilderness, you know, was actually visited by thousands and thousands of people. There's a backstory to this. Sorry, I can't go into it, but it's a little competition between the Catskill Mountain House and the Catterskill Hotel. But if you get a chance, look it up on Google, and I think you'll find kind of humorous and an interesting story. Okay, next slide. Okay, so today, although the Catskill Mountain House and Catterskill Hotel and many other large hotels don't exist anymore, there is one left over, and that's the Mohonk Mountain House. And although it's not in the Catskills per se, it's in the Shawangunks, it is still in the Hudson River Valley. It exists today. It's very popular, and it's just a beautiful spot. But it kind of harkens you back to those bygone days of the grand hotels in the Catskills. Next slide, please. So it's in this backdrop of long existing hotels and resorts at the start of the 20th century that the Spanish villas make their entrance. La Perla was de Cuba, the Pearl of Cuba, was probably the first established, as far as I could, as far as my research would indicate. It was established in 1912. There was also the Hotel Havana that's pictured in this photograph. Again, started by Cuban immigrants. Both of those hotels resided in Stamford, New York, which is actually Greene County. So almost on the other side of the Catskill Range. But they were some of the earliest hotels. Next slide. Okay, so the first Plattekill Villa that was established by Alejandro and Maria Rodriguez. And it was called Villa Rodriguez. And that's an early photo of it here. You can see there's a dirt road. So this goes back quite a ways. This is located on Unionville Road in Plattekill. Next slide. Okay, so like many of the other resorts that already existed, the villas also advertise in order to draw customers. So here, there's a couple of examples of advertising on the villas and other resorts. You can see in the top one, the news article, to the far left, you can see Villa Garcia, Hotel Perla de Cuba, and Hotel Havana. So those were all popular at the time. This is early in the 20th century. Below that, the Brooklyn Daily Eagle was very popular for hotels and resorts to advertise. They did a great job of advertising resorts in the Hudson Valley. You can see here, there's the Catskill Mountains. They advertise in general. There's other things they advertise. On the right is more or less a catalog. So there were newspaper ads. There were also catalogs that people published. And the one that you see there, the Roxmore Inn, that started out as non-Hispanic. And then eventually in the 20th century, a Spanish family purchased it, kept the name though, Roxmore Inn, and ran it as a villa or as a summer resort. Next slide. Again, this is an example of the directories where resorts of all sorts would be advertised. And it wasn't, in this case, with the Brooklyn Eagle, they even advertise in the Northeast, anywhere from New Hampshire, Maine, New England, and New York. So that was a popular way for people to find out about these resorts and then decide which ones they would like to visit. Next slide. Again, just another example of these directories. One is, you can see it's 1907. The other one is 1917 by the Brooklyn Daily Eagle. Next slide. Okay, so this is, if you would look inside the Brooklyn Daily Eagle, this is what the directory would look like. It was partitioned by areas. So in this one, you see Hudson River West. There would also be a Hudson River East. There would be, you know, there would be Upper Hudson. There would be further north. So in this one, you can see towns that you might identify: Montgomery, New York, Newburgh, Wallkill, and Wallkill alone. Each town had multiple places that you could actually go and spend a summer vacation during the summer months. Wallkill there itself has about 10 different places. Some were farms, some were boarding houses, some were more elaborate resorts, but and they would give you a count of how many rooms they had, how many people they could accommodate. So it was very helpful. And as you can see, there were literally hundreds of towns in New York State alone that advertised places to stay. So there were thousands of places where you could go. We always think of the Catskill Mountains and those places like that as being very isolated and remote. But with the transportation, like trains and so forth, you could get practically anywhere in the Catskills within a reasonable time, really. So although they were remote, they were very much visited by tourists. Next slide, Teresa. Again, like I say, boats, trains, and automobiles. You know, you could get to these resorts in different ways. Early in the 19th century, naturally, there were no cars, so people had to resort to trains. And what they would sometimes do is they would get on a boat in New York City. And back in those days, and I'll show that in the upcoming slide, there was the day line, and it would travel between New York City and Albany and all points in between. So you could take a boat to Kingston, get off in Kingston, take a train, and that would get you almost anywhere into the Catskills and to these various resorts. Next slide, Teresa. Okay, so here's an example of the Hudson River Day Line. This one is the Robert Fulton. This is very typical. This is early in the century, but they were very popular in the 19th century. And coincidentally, I have a picture of it with the walkway or the Poughkeepsie Railroad Bridge in the background, which eventually would become the walkway over the Hudson. Yeah, so like I said, it traveled between New York City and Albany, and very, very common. They traveled daily. You'd have one boat going up to Albany and one coming down from Albany. Next slide, thank you. Okay, and so the trains, as I mentioned, the boat would get you to Kingston, the Ulster and Delaware Railroad line, which would travel from Kingston west and south, all the way out toward Downsville, Pine Hill, places like that. So here's an example of a station at Haynes Corners and an old railroad train, but very popular, very easy way to get to the villas. The trains also ran from New York City on the western shore of the Hudson all the way up to Albany. And again, you could take a train, get off in Kingston, then catch the Ulster Delaware Railroad line and get to any resort you might be interested in going to. Next slide, Teresa. Okay, and of course, when everything else failed, there was the faithful old Model T. Once roads became available and you could then, in the early 20th century, you could drive to the resort of choice if you could afford a car back in those days. Next slide, Teresa. Okay, so let's find out what were Las Villas. Las Villas, as they were collectively known, they were independent resorts, but together they were known as Las Villas, and that just became a common term for people who were coming up from New York City, because sometimes they knew which villa they were going to, and sometimes they would just come up and go to multiple villas, so they would just say, let's go to Las Villas. They were both Spanish, and most of them were Spanish, run by Spanish immigrants or Puerto Ricans. There were summer resorts, mostly open during the summer, although some were open year-round. They were located mostly in Plattekill, where there was a concentration, but they were also located in other areas of the Catskills. Along the Route 28 corridor, there were quite a few. They dotted the Hudson Valley. They were in multiple towns. You could find a villa in Pine Hill, Shandaken, Phoenicia, Shokan, Ellenville, Rifton, Stamford, the town of Newburgh, Wallkill, and of course Plattekill. So it was spread out quite a bit. Next slide. So as I mentioned, the first villas were started by Spanish immigrants, especially in Plattekill. And what happened was the older resorts and boarding houses, as they went out of business, the Spaniards would come up and purchase those properties. They would buy a farm and maybe start a small farm with chickens or cows, and then supplement their income by taking in boarders. And of course, there were boarding houses that could be converted, small hotels. And so that's how the first ones got started. And basically, like the other resorts, they wanted a place where they could go and gather and socialize with people of similar language and similar background and culture. And that's what they did. And besides the Hispanics, Latinos, Spaniards, and Puerto Ricans, other groups did this as well. There were Italian villas, there were Irish resorts, and there were German resorts. So, you know, by all means, multiple ethnic groups had the same kinds of vacations, same ideas. The first places was just a matter of just getting out into the country, relaxing, and enjoying the scenery. It wasn't until later that they started to provide more amenities. And the larger the villa or resort, the more amenities you might get. By the 1940s, Puerto Rican families, like my family, came up and started to purchase farms, boarding houses, and resorts to start their own villas. Next slide. So we touched on this a little bit. What was the draw to the villas? Next slide, please. So at first it was just getting out into the country, enjoying the fresh air, the peacefulness, and maybe playing some outdoor games, playing dominoes, playing cards, anything like that. But eventually, by far, the most popular form of entertainment became the music, at least in the Latin villas. You would usually hear the traditional Spanish, Puerto Rican type music. At first it was the country music. In Puerto Rico they would call jibaro music or mountain music. But you would also hear other Latin type rhythms. The group on the left is the Trio San Juan, very typical kinds of music. And Teresa, if you could, we can give you a sampling of what a trio might sound like at the villas. Thank you, Teresa. So that was not the Trio San Juan, that was Trio Los Panchos. So there were many, many trios that performed in New York City, in Puerto Rico, and throughout the villas, you know. And like I say, the music was very traditional, very popular, especially when I was growing up with the older generation who were used to hearing that kind of music. It was very ballad-like, very romantic. And then some of the groups got a little bigger, and some of the bigger resorts, like my parents' resort and some of the other ones, Villa Garcia, Villa Nueva, Villa Guadarramas, they were able to get larger groups. And they would get bands that sounded very much like Tito Puente. And we have a sample of that kind of music. And Teresa, if you could play that. Thank you, Teresa. Okay, so I don't know if that came through. It came a little kind of spotty for me, but just to give you an idea, that there was a guajira, what most people refer to as a cha-cha-cha, and that was El Cayuco by Tito Puente, who was probably, if not the most famous Latin band in the world, one of the most famous. And there were many, many bands like that with the big sound, with the brass, and it was really quite enjoyable to listen to this music when you came to the Villas. Okay, Teresa, next slide. Okay, so in fact, some of the most famous Latin bands in the world did perform at Las Villas. On the left, we heard them earlier, El Gran Combo. In the middle is Tito Rodriguez, a big band. On the right, it was an up-and-coming band during the 60s. A bunch of young kids, really, started a band called the New Swing Sextet. Very, very popular. They played at my parents' Villa for a number of years. They had their own sound, peculiar sound. No brass, mostly percussion-type things, drums and other percussion instruments. And in fact, this band is playing even till today. If you go to some of the places where they still play the Latin music, you'll hear them playing. Next slide, Teresa. Okay, so if the music wasn't enough, and if that didn't get you to the villas, then the food certainly would. And it was mostly traditional food. I mean, you could get burgers and steak and things like that, but for the most part, people came up to get the traditional Puerto Rican or Spanish, the ethnic foods. On the left, you would have the paella, very famous with Spanish. On the right are empanadas, which Puerto Ricans call pastelillos. They're filled with either meat, usually meat, beef, chicken, pork, or cheese. But it would be foods like that and many, many others that, you know, that they would offer at the different villas. Next slide, please. So for many years, this went on in Plattekill and throughout the Catskills. The villas, when they existed, were the most popular vacation destination for Latinos in the entire Northeast. I would bet that you could talk to 8 or 9 out of 10 people in somewhere in the city, and they would either know of Las Villas or they had visited it, because they went on for over 80 years. So a lot of families got to enjoy the Villas, visited the Villas. Sometimes it's remarkable to me. I just identify with them so much. I grew up in the villa. I worked in the villa for my parents. I was a waiter and a bartender. I did the outside chores and things like that. So it just came second nature to me. It seemed so obvious that everyone would know about them, but they were kind of a secret to many people, even to some locals who lived in neighboring towns, weren't familiar with them, but they did exist. They existed for a long time, and they were very, very popular with the Latin community. Okay, next slide. So just to give you an idea of what some of the villas were, I have a list here of villas. This is the Villa Nueva, owned by Spaniards Severino and Amor Garcia. It was in Plattekill, just off of the Plattekill-Ardonia Road. It was probably the largest villa in Plattekill and offered a lot, had a lot of rooms, had a lot of amenities. Next slide. The Villa Galicia was another villa owned by Fred and Mary Somoza. It was eventually sold to Roberto and Fela Gomez, located in Plattekill on the Plattekill-Ardonia Road again. Next slide. There was the Villa Garcia. This is one of the older villas and well-established. Celestino and Flora Garcia, Spanish immigrants out of Asturias. Eventually, that also was sold. It was sold to a Puerto Rican family, Clemente and Judy Rodriguez. They renamed it and they called it the Villa Casablanca on the Plattekill-Ardonia Road. Many of these villas were on Plattekill-Ardonia Road, as was Sunny Acres, the villa that my parents owned. Many of them were on Unionville Road or Route 32. Next slide. Okay, this is the Casa Perez. Daniel and Dalia Perez. It again was sold, also renamed to Villa Campo Alegre, and that was owned by Andres Figueroa. And on, this might have been one of the last villas to go out of business. It lasted a long time. Andres is still alive. He's in his 90s. He's still pretty active, you know, functionally. He's very with it. And yeah, so this was one of the, sadly enough, it was one of the last of the villas around. Next slide. The Villa Guadarramas was on Unionville Road, owned by Pedro and Gonzalo Guadarramas, along with Pedro's brother, Gabriel. They bought it in 1957. Prior to that, it was the Villa Rodriguez. As I mentioned, that was the oldest villa in Plattekill. They purchased it in 1957, renamed it to Villa Guadarramas, and you know, beautiful tree-lined homes and things like that. So next slide. This is the Villa Victoria, one of the first villas that you'll see as you enter Plattekill from the south, going north on Route 32. The buildings still stand. It was the Cafe 32, I think, most recently. But this was owned by Anna, Joe, and Rita Vega. Joe was the son of Anna, who started the villa. Villa Victoria was named after her daughter, Victoria. Next slide. Okay, and this is the Villa Madrid, again, started by Spanish immigrants, obviously from Madrid. Manuel and Pilar Tafal. This was on Plattekill-Ardonia Road, where it intersects, where South Street intersects Plattekill-Ardonia Road, which today is Dombrowski Orchards. This was a villa that had accommodations and a small dining room. I don't think they provided music, but it was one of those early, early villas that you went there just for the relaxation aspect of it. So this is a sampling of the villas. There were many, many villas that existed over the years. Next slide, please. Okay, so you might wonder how long were the villas around. The era of the villas existed from 1912, which is the earliest one I can think of, until the 1990s, and even probably a little bit into the 2000s. What I call the golden era of the villas was 1950 to 1980. That's when the most people were frequenting the villas and vacationing at the villas. And that would be a good 30 years. On weekends, you could hardly get through the town of Plattekill. There were so many cars. They also brought in buses called giras, and they were chartered buses that would come up with busloads of people, sometimes as many as 10 or 20, just to one villa. They would provide them with food. Your ticket to the villas would include the bus ride, the food, and all the music that came free of charge. And it would just be a great day in the country and at the villas. At its peak, there were probably 40 to 50 villas that were active at any one time. The sign that you see, both these signs existed right in the village of Plattekill, close to where the general store now is. And you can see some of the names on there. These signs were erected by an association called Tavern Owners Association. And it was formed to benefit all the villas so that they could advertise and find a way to reach out to their customer base. Okay, so you might ask, what happened to the villas? So the villas started to slide and to fade quickly after 1985. People, especially the younger generations, were finding other destinations. Flyaway vacations were becoming popular. Atlantic Casino was popular. And so slowly but surely, they started to lose their popularity. Very much like the Jewish resorts up near in Sullivan County, they started to fade as well. And the villas became victim to the same sorts of things. Today, if you were to ride up to the villas, what you would find is some buildings have been converted to be apartments. Some are dilapidated and falling down. Some have just burned to the ground. And some are just empty parcels overgrown with weeds and things like that. So if you think about what they were and what has happened to them, it's really kind of a sad story. But I like to always think back on the great times at the villas. And I like to retell the story just to keep them alive in some respect. Next slide, please. Okay, so thank you for your kind attention to that. That's my presentation. I hope you enjoyed it. I made it a little bit different. I try to change every presentation because I don't want it to be redundant. I like to talk about it, and I could possibly talk about it for hours. If you're interested in my book, there are a number of ways that you can obtain it. You can email me. I don't know if my email is there, is it, Teresa?
Yes.
Okay, you can email me. It's also, if you want a signed copy, email me and I can get that to you. It's also available in any number of places online. It's also available at some of the Barnes and Nobles. I think there's Kingston carries it, Newburgh, and even the Peekskill or the Cortland Barnes and Noble carries it. So that's it. So pass the word around. The villas will live on. It's a part of our history. And thank you for listening.
All right. A big virtual round of applause for Martinez for joining us with that fascinating bit of Hudson Valley history. If you want to relive Ish's presentation, or you have a friend or a family member who didn't get to join us for the live presentation but still wants to see this, we're going to put it up on our website and on our Facebook page as quickly as possible. So keep an eye on walkway.org or our Facebook page, facebook.com/walkwayoverthehudson, if you don't already follow us. And we'll have this video up either later tonight or sometime tomorrow. So keep an eye out for that. Ish is willing to answer questions if anyone has any. There is a chat function at the bottom of Zoom. If you have a question for Ish or a general walkway question that we may be an answer for you, type it in there, and we'll get those questions answered for you in just a second. As you're formulating them, thinking about what you might want to say, I know our executive director, Elizabeth Waldstein, is with us and wants to extend her thanks to Ish. Elizabeth, are you on? Are you unmuted?
Yes, no, I think I'm unmuted. I figured out this technology in my declining years here. But anyway, I love that the walkway was called the Great Connector in 1889. And the most gratifying thing for me and the staff and a lot of our board members is those connections. So Ish, thank you for connecting us to an era that many of us didn't know about. Thank you for reminding us of the wonderful music from the entire Latin culture and what wonderful music they've shared with the world. So to continue to be the great connector, if you belong to another organization or group and you'd like to have Ish talk, that's one way to do it. And secondly, if you have a bit of history, culture, or anything about the Hudson Valley that you want to share with us, Teresa and her team have done a great job of pulling together these talks. So thank the board members that are on, thank Teresa, then the staff, and Ish, thank you very much. It's really fascinating. We'll have you back again. Sometimes when we say, do we want to repeat these? And I say, well, there's only 50 people that saw it and there's probably 500 that want to. So there's always room to come back. Thank you very much. Thanks everybody for joining us.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
We mentioned off the top that we had a number of board members on the call. Our board chair has joined us, John Stork, who is always a great fan of our Walkway Lecture Series. And at this time, John would like to extend his thanks to Ish as well. John, are you with us? Are you unmuted?
Now I am unmuted.
There he is.
Yeah. Actually, I live only a few miles from Plattekill. I have a lot of friends there. As a kid, I would go to Puerto Rico every winter. My grandparents lived in Puerto Rico. I am in Mexico right now, as you can all see. I'm in Mexico. That's my winter home. So this culture is inside me all the time. I'm in the music business. And I only regret that more of these villas and more of the music aren't there. But the walkway is there. The traditions are there. And thank you, Ish, for reminding us of those traditions. And thank everybody for coming in. The walkway is, of course, a physical connector, but it's also an amazing cultural connector. Thanks again. Thank you so much.
Great.
Thank you, John.
Thank you.
If you would be willing to share your email address one more time, just to make sure that...
Yeah, that'd be good.
Okay. Yep, I'll get there. Here it is.
Okay.
My annotation didn't work too well, but there it is.
Yeah, we go back a slide. There it is.
We did, Ish, get a couple of questions that perhaps you may have the answer to. The first, I think, very fitting to our current climate. Do you know if there was any effect on the villas from the 1918 pandemic, the last time that we experienced anything like this?
No, I haven't heard anything about that. Keep in mind that there were, at that time, there were not too many villas in existence, just a handful. The owners that owned those villas, I think it was the Stanford area, and there were a handful of villas up there, and they were Cuban immigrants, so they would travel, you know, to Cuba and then back in the summertime to run the hotels and such. And I haven't heard any impact on the villas regarding the Spanish flu.
Ish, were there any located on the east side of the river near the Poughkeepsie area?
Not to my knowledge, no. I have not come across, in my research, I haven't come across any that were on the east side.
That concludes the question and answer session.
Thanks again.
One more. Did any locals take advantage of the restaurants, or were they mostly limited to the guests?
No, actually, some locals did take advantage of the restaurants, particularly the restaurants that stayed open off-season, like the Villanueva was a very good example of a villa that stayed open. They had a restaurant, and many of the locals would use the restaurant. They also had dances at some of the villas, and, you know, either political groups or other organizations would hold dances at the villas, and so, you know, the locals would join in on that too. And in fact, many of the locals worked at the villas in one form or another, either, you know, lawn maintenance, as maids, as waiters, as bartenders. So yeah, It wasn't exclusive to just Latinos. A lot of non-Latinos found it a way to get some summer work and also, you know, enjoy what the Villas had to offer.
Well, thanks again to Ish Martinez for this very informative lecture. If you enjoyed this, we are now ready to announce our next virtual lecture, which will take place the same bat time and the same bat channel next week, Sunday, 1 p.m. Joe Bertolozzi is going to join us. Joe is the creator of Bridge Music, where he has quite literally traveled, well, around the Hudson Valley to the Mid-Hudson Bridge and around the world to places like the Eiffel Tower, making music from different structures. Very, very interesting type of art that Joe created, and he will join us next week at 1 p.m. We really hope that y'all enjoyed this historical look at Las Villas from Ish Martinez. We hope that you'll join us again next week. And again, if you see fit to be able to support this type of programming, we would greatly appreciate if you could text in or visit walkway.org/donate and kick into our virtual tip jar, our virtual donation jar, so that we can keep these things going. And we hope you all stay safe, stay warm, stay out of the rain. Walkway over the Hudson is open during regular hours. We are now asking that everyone who visits please wear a face covering. That's just because there are areas of the park where it's very, very difficult to maintain social distancing. So we want everyone to be safe. We want the walkway to stay open. And we hope that you can all continue to enjoy it at this time. So on behalf of Elizabeth and everyone that's working with the Friends Group, our entire board of directors, and of course Ish, thank you for spending an hour of time with us here this Sunday, and we hope we'll see you next week. Bye, everybody.